Thank you. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. Today, I will talk about symplectic displacement energy for exact Lagrangian immersions. Displaceability or non-displaceability is an interesting phenomenon in symplectic topology or Hamiltonian dynamics. And for example, the Arnold conjecture asks the non-displaceability of a Lagrangian submanifold under Hamiltonian isotropy. And today, I will explain a lower bound of displacement energy for exact Lagrangian immersions. And our approach is based on Floer theory for Lagrangian immersion and Chekhanov's homotopy technique. Okay, first, let me explain our notation. Let M be a symplectic manifold with a symplectic form omega. And iota, a Lagrangian immersion. Namely, iota is an immersion, and the dimension of L is a half of the dimension of M, and the iota pullback of omega is equal to zero. And we call a Lagrangian immersion exact if this symplectic area is equal to zero for any pair of Smith maps U from two-dimensional disk to M, and U bar from the boundary to L, such that the composition of iota and U bar is equal to the restriction of U on the boundary. Okay, this is the definition of exact Lagrangian immersion. And moreover, we consider teardrop disks. Let V be a map from the disk to M, and V bar is a map from the 0-1 interval to L, which satisfies the following condition. First, V bar of 0 is not equal to V bar of 1, and the composition of iota and V bar is equal to the restriction of V on the boundary. Here we identify exponential 2 pi I theta with theta. We call such a pair of V and V bar a teardrop disk. So let me draw a figure. So this is L, and this is the image of L, oh sorry, iota. And V is a map from disk to M. And V bar is a map from the interval to L. And the composition of iota and V bar coincided with the restriction of V on the boundary. Okay, and we call such a map teardrop disks. And moreover, we define sigma to be the infimum of the positive symplectic area of teardrops. So if there is no teardrop, then we define sigma plus infinity. Okay, next. Let H be a time-dependent Hamiltonian vector field on M. Then we denote by XH the Hamiltonian vector field, and phi H T the Hamiltonian isotropy. And then Hopper defined some kind of norm for H, so-called Hopper norm, by this integral. Okay, then we can explain our main theorem. First, let M be a closed symplectic manifold or non-compact with convex end. And iota an exact Lagrangian immersion. With L compact, and we assume that the imaged points are transverse. This is our step. And then, if the Hopper norm is less than sigma, the infimum of the symplectic area of TH dot, and the iota and the phi H1 iota intersect transversely, then we obtain the following inequality. The number of intersection points of iota and phi h1 iota is greater than or equal to the dimension of the singular homology of M. Okay, this is our main theorem. And as a corollary, we obtain a lower bound of the displacement energy of our exact Lagrangian immersion. Let A be a subset of M, and we define the displacement energy for A by the infimum of the Hopper norm of H to the Hamiltonian isotropy displace A. So if any Hamiltonian cannot displace A, then we put the displacement energy plus infinity. Okay, then as a corollary, we obtain a lower bound of the displacement energy of our Lagrangian immersion. Namely, sigma is smaller than or equal to the displacement energy of the image of the overall immersion. Okay, this is our main theorem and the corollary. So the displacement energy of a Lagrangian submanifold was already discussed by several people, Porterovich, Chekhanov, Yongyong-Oh, and so on. And in particular, Chekhanov obtained the same type inequality for rational Lagrangian submanifold and with the symplectic area of holomorphic disk. So this is our main theorem is the imagined version of Chekhanov. Okay, and then our proof is based on Floer theory, and the next I want to explain. So first, we consider the following path space and a functional on it. So first, fix a constant x, and so fix. And a point x0 of L. And then we define the capital omega to be the set of pairs of maps gamma and gamma bar, where gamma is a map from 0, 1 interval to n, and gamma bar is a map from 0, 1 to l, such that the composition of iota and gamma bar is equal to the restriction of gamma on the boundary. And moreover, there is a map U from 0,1 times 0,1 to M, and U bar from 0,1 times 0 and 1 to L, which satisfies the following condition. Okay, 0, 1 times 0, 1. First, this H goes to the image of X0. This edge. And this edge goes to gamma t. And this guy goes to the composition of iota and u bar. And this guy goes to the composition of iota and u bar. Okay, let me draw a figure. So this is the image of immersion, and this is gamma, and here is iota of x0. It is like this. So we consider a pair of maps gamma and gamma bar, which satisfies this condition. And moreover, we define a functional on this path space. By the minus symplectic area of U, minus this Hamiltonian part. And in fact, this function functional does not depend on the choices of U, because our Lagrangian immersion is exact. And moreover, the critical point of this functional is an orbit of the Hamiltonian vector field of SH. So we define CS the set of critical points of this function. And we need more something. I have to prepare one more function. First, let's take kappa between 0 and sigma and an interval from B minus to B plus, such that B minus is negative and B plus is positive, and the difference is kappa. First, we choose such kappa and B minus and the interval. And moreover, define Fs from the critical point set to this interval, so that Fs of gamma is equal to the capital S of gamma modulo kappa. We need such function. And then we define the moduli space of gradient trajectory of our functional. Okay, for let gamma and delta be a critical point. And then if capital S of gamma minus capital S of delta is equal to the small f S of gamma minus small f S of delta, then we define the moduli space of gradient trajectory as follows. So M S. The moduli space defined by the set of U and U bar. Here, U is a map from R times 0, 1 to N, and U bar is a map from R times 0 and 1 to L, such that the composition of iota and U bar coincided with the restriction of U on the boundary. And moreover, the limit tau minus infinity of U or plus infinity is equal to gamma t or delta t. And similarly, the limit of gamma minus infinity or plus infinity of U bar tau I coincide with gamma bar or U bar where I is 0 or 1. Or moreover, U satisfies the following equation. Okay, this is a equation of gradient trajectory. And moreover, in this case, R acts on parameter tau. So we divide by R, the action. Okay, this is our moduli space. And moreover, so if this is not equal to the small f, the difference of small f, then we define our moduli space to be empty. Okay, this is our moduli space of gradient trajectory. And there are some important remarks. Now first, if S is very small, then this gradient trajectory is almost J-homomorphic. And moreover, this condition, capital F gamma of gamma minus capital Fs of delta is nothing but the energy of U. And in this case, this energy is smaller than kappa because this difference is smaller than or equal to kappa, or smaller than kappa. So in this, the energy of gradient trajectory of our moduli space is smaller than kappa. This is very important to remark. Then, as usual in Floer theory, these moduli spaces are smooth finite dimensional manifold for generic J, H, S, and so on. And moreover, we have the following compactness theorem. Okay, this is just the definition. Yeah. So, definition. Yeah, actually, the energy of gradient trajectory does not depend on the choices of U for fixed critical points. So, yeah, anyway. So this is the definition now. Yes. I read this part. So then, the energy of gradient trajectory over moduli spaces are very small. So we can have the following compactness theorem. First, zero-dimensional component of a moduli space is compact because if we had disk bubble, then the tail component should be a holomorphic disk or teardrops. But since our Lagrangian immersion is exact, then there is no disk bubble. And moreover, the energy of our gradient trajectories is smaller than kappa, so there is no teardrop bubble. So anyway, first, a zero-dimensional component of our moduli space are compact. And secondly, the one-dimensional component of our moduli space can be compactified such that the boundary consists of the broken trajectory. So we put, since we put this energy condition, we can compactify our moduli space. We have a compactness theorem, our moduli space, like this. And then, once we have such compactness theorem, we can define chain complex. Let C be a free module generated by critical points of capital F, and moreover, we define the boundary operator from CS to CS by counting the number of points of the dimensional component of our moduli space. And as usual, we obtain a chain complex. We denote by H of CS, CS, the homology. Okay, and there are some important remarks. this homology is not the invariant of S or H or da da da. So this homology may change and changing Hamiltonian one and so on. But we can see the following phenomena. So okay. Let's consider a tiny S. Then the Hamiltonian vector field of SH is also small. So then there are two types of critical points like this. First one is this tiny guy, and the second one is this guy. And we call this guy type A. This is also type A. And we call these guys type B. So type A attached on the same sheet, but type B switch the sheet. Then we define AS to be the free module of critical points of type A. And similarly, we define BS to be the free module generated by type B. And CS is a direct sum of AS and BS as a free module. And moreover, we can prove the following theorem. Okay, then there exists S0 such that if S is smaller than S0, then our boundary operator has no cross term. Which means our chain complex CS is a direct sum of the chain complexes A and B. So let me sketch the proof. So consider the case of S small. Then the trajectory between type A and type B is almost J homomorphic. Then the symplectic area of this trajectory should be greater than or equal to greater than or equal to the infimum of the symplectic area of teardrops. But the energy of a trajectory must be smaller than or equal to sigma, because we put this condition. So there is no such trajectory, and then there is no cross term between A and B. And there is some remarks. As usual in the Floer theory, the homology of type A, oh sorry, S is small, then the homology of the type A is isomorphic to the singular homology of L. Moreover, so far, we don't use the Hofer norm yet. So, next step is we want to compare the homology of the case S small and S large. Then we will use the Hofer norm. So, okay. The next, take H. Kappa and sigma, kappa and interval such that e minus smaller than minus integral of max t of x. Minus minimum and so we can choose H which satisfies this condition because we can add some constant. And we can add some constant to Hamiltonian. And so that the Hamiltonian vector field does not change. So anyway, so we can add, we add some constant to H, and then we can take H, kappa, and the interval which satisfies these conditions. Minus max. Minus. This one. So, okay. And moreover, okay, and then here we use Hofer norm. Okay, the Hofer norm appear here, and we use this condition to find such kappa and h, and moreover, we prepare the following function. We call this function rho plus. So the capital S is almost 1, and the small s is very small. And then we define the following moduli space. Gamma is. A critical point of the functional for small s, and delta is a critical point of the function of the capital S. And then, if capital F of gamma minus capital F of this large S, delta, is equal to the small s of gamma minus small f of delta, then we define the moduli space rho plus the set of pairs of u and u bar, where u is a map from the map from r times 0 interval to n, and the u bar is r times 0 and 1 to n, such that a similar boundary condition and asymptotic condition, and moreover, you satisfy the following equation. So here, t plus, sorry, minus large s, rho plus h. And this time, r does not act on, R does not act on the parameter term, so we don't divide. So this is the moduli space. And similarly, if this condition does not hold, then we put the moduli space empty by definition. to define chain homotopy, we prepare such moduli spaces. And then we can prove the following compactness theorem of these moduli spaces. We can prove the following conductive theorem. First, there is S0 such that if S is smaller than S0 and gamma is a critical point of the CS of type A and delta is a critical point of the function of capital S, then the zero dimensional component of this moduli space is compact. We need this assumption. And moreover, the one dimensional component of this moduli space can be compactified such that the boundary consists of the following growing projections. The first type is such compactness theorem, then we can define a chain homotopy between a different s or a small s to large s. This part is small s.
this part corresponds to this part. Gamma is a type S, type A. So this boundary operator comes from here. And this capital phi plus comes from here. And then theta is also type A. And moreover, the right hand side, this part comes from here. Theta and delta is. So if S is big, then we have no height. And this guy comes from, this guy comes from this guy for gamma of type A. Then once we have, this is all. Okay. And then as a property, so we obtain a homomorphism from. Construct is a chain map from type A to so yeah, actually first I wanted to construct a chain map from for C to C, but I couldn't. So the answer is we can construct the chain map from type A to C. Okay, almost finished. And it's now we can break the paper. We want to know the number of intersection points of iota and phi h1 of iota. And this number is equal to the generators of the chain complex for capital X. And this is also, this is greater than y equal to the dimension for capital S. And then we prove that our chain map is injected from here to here, and then this dimension is smaller than or equal to the dimension of the homology of type A. And as usual, this is isomorphic to the singular homology of A. Then we obtain our main goal. Okay, I'll stop here.